This morning, I want to challenge all of us, go ahead, to be the example of the example that was before you on this Baptist Men's Day. We're pilgrims on the journey on the narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary. Our lives a stirring testament of God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. After all our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind, may the clues that they discover, may the memories they uncover, become the light that leads them to the road we each must find. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. And the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful.
Thank you, Scott. Good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church. Will you pray with me, please? Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, for this church, for the freedom we have to come and assemble and to worship you. I ask your continued blessings on us here at this church, on each family that's represented here. Please guide our thoughts as we go through this service. Please guide our actions as we go out into the community and try to be the kind of people you'd want us to be. Please forgive us when the many times that we fail. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand as we sing our hymn of praise, number 227, Praise Him, Praise Him. Please stand.
Don't quit on account of me. Welcome to everybody at First Baptist Church. Good to be together. There are various announcements in your bulletin. Of course, we have a guest speaker this morning, and I've written a brief introduction to him in the bulletin. I'll give a more complete introduction to him before Joe Bowen speaks. But notice the Beacon of Hope sock collection we're promoting, the 4B's trip on February 4th, Super Bowl Sunday, February 7th. And the annual Super Bowl party that some of us go and help with in inner city Lexington at Calvary Baptist Church on the 7th. You notice there the Kroger Community Rewards Program, an announcement from the Bereavement Committee, and so on. One item not in the bulletin that I would like to add is that the Sanctuary Choir will begin its rehearsals for the cantata, the Easter cantata, at 7:15 this Wednesday, and all are welcome. And if there are any other men in the congregation that want to join the choir, you won't be disturbing us if you rise and go join the choir for the special song that they're going to sing. If you're visiting with us, we hope you'll sign in on the registration form there and place it in the offering plate. We want to thank all that cooked breakfast this morning. Somebody said it smells like old ham in this place. Well, it was old ham and a lot of other good victuals. And as they say, a good time was had by all. Amen? And the water fountain's right out here in the hallway if you're thirsty. And Joe, I've got your water up here on the right side. Mine goes on the left. I'm left-handed. So I won't touch yours if you won't touch mine. Any other announcements? If not, we have a great hymn to stand and sing together, number 342, Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me. May we stand. John Barker, will you lead us in our offertory prayer?
Our Lord and our Father, we thank you again, Lord, for your many blessings. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who died upon the cross for the remission of our sins. We ask that thou will forgive us of our sins, that you will strengthen us in our faith, that you may lead us in the path of righteousness for thy name's sake. We thank you, O Lord, for this day, for your blessings, and for this offering, we pray that thou will bless the gift as well as the giver. We pray, O Lord, that thou be with our speaker, that thou will lay thy words upon his heart, and that thou will open our hearts and our ears to be attentive to and in tune to thy word. Forgive us, O Lord, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. As we continue in worship, we always take note of our prayer list as it is printed there in the bulletin. I've learned today that a member of our community in Clark County, Joe Robinson, was taken to the hospital over the weekend. Many of you know Joe. He's not a member here, but we keep him in our prayers. And Helen Barnett has been taken to Clark Regional Medical Center. So keep her and that family in your prayers. Zella Saylor, Ben Swanner, Elizabeth Ann Spa, Virginia Wiseman, Hallie McLeod in retirement homes. For our scripture today, I've chosen a responsive reading in your hymnal taken from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, number 701, responsive reading number 701. Out of respect for God's word, may we stand together as we read responsively. 701. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not love, it profiteth me nothing.
Love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself. It is not puffed up. Doth not behave itself seemingly. Seeketh not her own. It is not easy to revolt.
Thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never faileth.
But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part.
But when that which is perfect is come, that which is in part shall be done away.
And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest of these is love.
May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated as we pray. Almighty God, we gather here this beautiful winter day with thanksgiving and adoration, realizing that thou art God, our Maker, and our Savior through Jesus Christ. We lift up your name in praise, and we come before you humbly, but with the confidence given to us by the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, through whom we are adopted as your children and invited into your presence. We lift up these of our fellowship in prayer. We lift up our community, our country. We offer ourselves humbly in confession of our sins, each and every one, individually and corporately. And we pray for your abiding presence with humanity in Jesus Christ. We pray for our speaker who brings before us today his own story and his own pilgrimage and walk with Christ. Bless him and keep him in your will, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.
Rise up.
And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Joe, they're leaving me up here with all my friends. It's a pleasure to introduce, as the men exit the choir loft, our guest speaker for the day. I'm going to brag on him a little bit so he won't have to quite as much. I first met Joe Bowen 2 years ago when he walked into the Native Baptist Mission to visit. And it wasn't long after that I recruited him to be the adult Sunday school teacher, which he's been doing ever since. Joe's a resident of Powell County. He's a native of Bowen, and his name is Joe Bowen. And Bowen is located on Highway 15, about halfway between Stanton and Nada. And you can't quite tell when you get there or when you leave, but there is a sign that says Bowen. Joe has written a couple of books, and I have one of them with me, Real Winners Don't Quit. He writes about his exploits. He mustered out of the military in California as an Air Force pilot in 1967. And he bought a bicycle and a backpack and whatever else he needed, and he bicycled a circuitous route through Canada and Grand Canyon, believe it or not, 14,000 miles across the United States. In 2005, some of you may recall the front page of the Winchester Sun had a feature story on Joe Bowen, who by then, I think he was 62 years old, rode across America again. And between that time, in 1980, when I was the new pastor of First Baptist Church of Cape Girardeau, Missouri, in southeast Missouri, where Missouri and Kentucky come together, it was in the news that a man was walking across the bridge across the Mississippi River on stilts. I remember reading it. It was Joe Bowen. I didn't meet him then, but I read all about him. With that said, let me share some information off of the flyleaf of his latest book. That Real Winners Don't Quit shares the adventures and life lessons of a man who lived Henry David Thoreau's words, quote, "Perhaps it is because he hears a different drummer." Some of these words come from Martha Lane Collins, who wrote the preface to his book, to this book. Some of you, of course, have heard of her. In 1967, Joe began a remarkable journey on a bicycle to discover America for himself. At the time, there had been crossings of America on a bicycle, but it was unheard of to travel 14,000 miles in 16 months on a bicycle. So he set a world record. He left Lompoc, California with $43.85 in his pocket. When he ran out of money, he worked a few days painting houses, putting up hay on a farm, or cutting firewood. In 1980, Joe wanted to raise money for one of his favorite charities, muscular dystrophy. With the help of his fellow JCs, his 308-mile walk, stilt walk, and you see his picture in your bulletin on the flyleaf, across America, set a world record and raised more than $100,000 for MDA. In 2005 and 6, at age 62, he bicycled 14,000 miles across America again as Kentucky's unbridled spirit. By way of a laptop, he took 8,000 elementary school children with him from eastern Kentucky, with whom he stayed in regular communication. He retired as a construction worker after working his way up to foreman, most of the time in Louisville, I've learned. He completed these journeys of a lifetime, raised a family of three girls, and more than $600,000 for his favorite charities. It has been said that, quote, he is an average Joe made unique by believing in the power within himself and of the human spirit. He lives in a beautiful home in the woods, which he built himself out of condemned wood, condemned houses wood, and some churches in Powell County, and operates a bed and breakfast there. He graduated from the University of Louisville while working construction in 1978. It took him 8 years of night classes. After his college work, he did his full-time work as a construction worker. In 1982, he wrote a self-published book, Stilt Walk. October of 79, at halftime during the University of Louisville homecoming football game, we'll forgive him for this, Joe was honored by the university by receiving their Outstanding Service Award. He's carried the Olympic torch twice, the Summer Games in 96 and the Winter Games of 2002. In 1986, Joe received the Ellis Island Medal of Honor Award along with Muhammad Ali, Gregory Peck, John Denver, Jacqueline Onassis, to mention a few, and I think Joe DiMaggio was there. He's a motivational speaker, bicyclist. He organizes marathon runs in Powell County, several hundred run in his annual Rugged Red. Maybe he'll tell you a little bit about that. In his book here that I won't give you, but I'll let you look at it, Joe was pictured doing things like backpacking in the Sierra Nevada mountains, water skiing on Lake Powell in Arizona behind an airplane, stilt walking with kids, walking with, that's John Y. Brown. He was governor, wasn't he? Walking here with, that's Joe DiMaggio, walking here with Anita Bryant. Anybody remember Anita Bryant in Florida Oranges, Miss America? Walking here with Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan, we've heard of those guys too. Joe, we've learned to love you at NADA and appreciate your work with us there and appreciate you. And when it gets time for you to quit, I'll raise my hand. But otherwise, you make yourself at home. Come on up here and spin a few yarns for us. We're lucky to have Joe Bowen as our guest speaker.
I sat over there and listened to a woman play an absolutely awesome piano. I don't know if you all have had the opportunity to watch her play. That woman has a passion for that music instrument, and she plays it with a passion. And that is what I hope when they lay me down, that they say that I lived with a passion. I told him I can't talk 30 minutes. I don't know how to stop. And it reminded me of a story that I heard a long time ago. But there was this man in Eastern Kentucky that had a construction company, and he had been very successful. And he went to church at a little Baptist church, and the preacher there had been doing a pretty good job, and everybody else, and they probably had a good piano player. But this church started growing. I mean, it was just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And this construction man told the congregation, said, "Look, I will build you a brand new church. Won't cost you a dime. I'll pay for it. However, I'm going to put a wooden fence around it, and I don't want nobody coming in it and messing with me while I'm building it. I don't want to hear all your opinions that you got." They agreed because it was free. He built the church. 6-8 months later, took the fence down. The roses, the plants are beautiful. The church is awesome. And the construction man is standing there, and he opened the door, and the congregation went in. And it reminded me of this congregation this morning. The congregation goes in, and they come through that back door up there, the front door, and there is only two sets of pews. And everybody is looking at themselves, and it's like, what is going on here? Well, they came in and filled those two pews up, and the construction guy went over to the wall and punched a button. And those pews moved forward about 2 feet, and another set of pews popped up. Wow! Everybody was just, it was unbelievable. Well, the church, there was about, it got about half full, and it looked like that was about all it was going to show up. The construction guy punched another button, and everything moved up to the podium. Wow, man! Well, this Baptist preacher gets up, and he starts, "I can't believe this. This is unbelievable." And he preached for 30 minutes, and then he preached for 45 minutes, and then an hour and 10 minutes. And all of a sudden, this guy pushed another button, and the podium and the preacher started disappearing in the bowl. Well, you all kind of remind me of that this morning. You're sitting back there somewhere. And Brother John can tell you that it's a whole lot more enjoyable talking to people when they're up close to you. But you all just stay seated, okay? We'll be okay. When I was a kid, I loved horses. And when I was about 14 or 15 years old, I'm going to tell you some stories that you probably are not going to believe. But I had these two stallions. And when I was 14, 15, 16 years old, I could ride these two stallions running in a gallop side by side. One pair of reins on this side, one pair of reins on this side, and I'm standing up on the backs of the horses. That was the beginning of me enjoying getting in front of a bunch of people. And you'll probably notice that this morning. I was raised by a dad that was an alcoholic. And he was violent. And I was with him when he died. And I asked the funeral director to let me go in the room with him. And he just had a sheet on him. And I pulled the sheet off of his face. And I kissed him a couple times on the forehead. And I said, "Dad, I love you. And I'm sorry that we've struggled." And then another incident that has been a major piece of my life. When I was in the fifth grade, the principal of Bowen Elementary School called my mom and told her to come to the school. And she got there and he called me into his office. And he set me and my mom down. And he was very openly. And he said, "Olga, Joe is a little bit slow, and he's struggling in school." Have you ever had anybody to tell you that you were slow, especially somebody that you thought was an incredible human being? But he told me I was slow. Well, the stuff that my dad did to me and knowing that I was slow is kind of like, you guys just stand back and watch, because I'm going to make up some ground. I'm not going to live this way all my life, and I'm not going to let that be something that's going to cripple me. I'm going to let that be something that's going to move me forward. And I did. And I did it in a very unfounded. I did it in an odd sort of way. And I did go out there, and I can remember now. I called home we was talking about different things with my mother, and then I started kind of thinking about, I'm going to break this news to her that I'm getting discharged. And she had always said to my dad, in a fun way, but kind of meant it too, said, "There's something wrong with that boy." And I heard it so much, I kind of got used to it and kind of enjoyed being that sort of person. But anyway, I called home, and she said, "Well, how long do you think it'll take you to get here, get home?" This is after I'm discharged. And I said, "Mom, the way I got it figured, I'll be there in 14 or 15 months. And she said, "What?" I said, "Yeah, I'm coming home on a bicycle. And I'm taking a zigzag route. I'm not coming straight to the house." And I heard her say, "Bill, there's something wrong with that boy." And there's been something wrong with me ever since. And I rode that bicycle. I rode that bicycle twice. And I walked across this country from Los Angeles to here. And then I walked from here to New York City for the St. Jude's Foundation. And then the Belgium Sports Committee got in touch with me, and I went to Europe with my family and walked parts of five countries in Europe for their cancer society. And then I wrote that book, Stilt Walk, and there's no one wants to read a book about stilt walking, and I published it myself. And the second book, Wheel Winners Don't Quit, a publishing company in Missouri published it. And they took too many of my rights away from me. They made me sign an agreement that if they ever made a movie of this or sold it to television, that they would get half of the money. I said, well, you guys wasn't out there walking with me when I was suffering. Why should you get half of it? But I went ahead and signed it because I wanted to see my book in print. It didn't matter. And on these trips, I will give you a few of them here. I have ridden a 5-person tricycle with President Jimmy Carter in Roseland. And I was invited by MGM to come and watch them make a movie in Sedona, Arizona. And the reason I got invited is because the name of the movie was Stay Away Joe. And Elvis Presley was the main character in the movie. And I spent 3 days with him and Burgess Meredith and Cotty Jurado and Thomas Gomez. Pretty cool. I was on another movie set called Stalking Moon with Gregory Peck and Eva Marie Saint, and got to set for about an hour and talked to Gregory Peck and Eva Marie Saint because we had all showed up early. I've met several governors around the country. And I've had some experiences that is absolutely off the chart. And Brother John, I'm probably going to go over, okay? In 1967, I had ridden about 9,000 miles. And I found myself in the little town of Claremore, Oklahoma. And the Claremore, Oklahoma newspaper had just done a front page story on me that was in that paper that day. And I'm in town looking at the things. That's Will Rogers' hometown. You know who Will Rogers is. And I'm looking around, and it's just incredible that I'm in his hometown. And I'm in my 20s, and an older couple in their 60s, they saw me, and they had seen the article. And they said, would you like to come? We're having a bean supper. We're a camping caravan called the Wally Baum Camper Airstream Trailers. Would you come and talk at our bean supper tonight? Tell us some stories. And I said, yeah, I'd like to. And they said, we'll feed you. Well, when somebody's going to feed me, I'll talk for a few minutes for free food, okay? And I went and started talking, and I knew when I went that Dr. Martin Luther King had been shot that day. I already knew that. And I went, and there was about 400, 500 older people in this little auditorium at the county fairgrounds. And I get up, and I start telling my stories. I'm almost finished. And a man comes running in and said, hey, I need the microphone. And he kept running down toward me, come up on the steps. I just handed him the microphone. And he said, ladies and gentlemen, Martin Luther King has just died. And about 20% of those older people in that auditorium stood up and started doing this. And I thought I was going to die right there. And I left that stage and went out the back door or the entrance door, and this old couple ran and caught me. And they apologized 40 times for that happening. Well, I rode the bicycle for the next several days, and I find myself on the north side of the Arkansas River approaching the city of Little Rock, and it was late in the afternoon. And this thing with Martin Luther King getting shot has shocked the world, and especially the South, and especially the black people. And I rode that bicycle into the Little Rock, Arkansas, and I saw a very desperate, desperate city, a beautiful southern city that was desperate. They did not know what to do. The black people were rioting. They were actually burning their own homes down. They were busting the windows out of the storefronts of the streets. And I'm a 22, 23-year-old young man from Eastern Kentucky that has never, ever experienced anything like this. And I am scared to death. And I continue riding down through South Little Rock. And it's getting late in the afternoon. And it's starting to get dark. And I stop at this little motel. And it's kind of like, I've got to get inside or I may get hurt tonight. And I stopped and I went in. And I sat down at there was a little cafe also. And I asked the lady, I said, how much is a room? And she said, it's $15. I said, $15? I said, ma'am, I said, Holiday Inn only charges about $9. And you're not Holiday Inn. Well, she said, if you don't stay here tonight for my price, she said, the niggers will get you when you get back out on the street. And I said, ma'am, I'm from Eastern Kentucky, and they'll get me before you get my money. I got back out on the street and got on that bicycle, and I kept on riding out of South Little Rock, and the lights, the street lights are starting to come on. They come on as it gets dark. And I am scared to death. And the people on the sides of the street busting out the windows and calling me some pretty bad names. And this guy was looking straight down the road. And I probably ran through a couple red lights because I was not stopping that bicycle. I knew that the only way anybody's going to catch me is he's going to have to be one fast runner because I can crank that bicycle. I got down on the out of town in South Little Rock. And I saw another little tiny motel with three or four rooms. And I stopped. And by this time, all the street lights are on. And the lights are off except an office light. And there's a little white note in the window. And it said, if you want a room, come to the house next door. I walked my bicycle over to this house, knocked on the door. This big 6'5" black man answered the door. I was in a mess. And I just spilled my guts out to this guy and I told him the whole story. He said, young man, he said, I'll give you a room for $2 and I'll guarantee you there ain't nobody gonna hurt you tonight. And he took me over and got me in this room and he said, put your bicycle in the room. And he said, do not answer that door. If anybody knocks on it, do not answer that door unless you hear my voice. 7 o'clock the next morning, I heard a knock on the door and I said, who is it? He said, it's Buford. I said, okay. And I opened the door. He said, my wife's got you a good breakfast fix. That sounds good. I went next door. She had fixed me eggs, biscuits, grits, gravy, everything you could imagine. I ate myself silly, and Buford said, you know, sit on the patio a little bit before you leave? And I said, yeah. So we went out. His patio was over on the side of the house, and here's his house, and there's the highway. And we're sitting in view of the highway, talking, drinking coffee. The city of Little Rock is coming apart. We're sitting there, and I see a television camera crew go down the street in a van. Slowed down, went on. That's why it came back up, slowed down again, but it went on. Next time it came down, slowed down, and it pulled in his driveway. And Buford looked over at me and he said, hey, Joe. He said, I called him this morning. I thought it'd be good for him to see a black man and a white man drinking coffee together. We did that interview. And then I went on down, headed toward Pine Bluff, about 50 miles down the road. Late in the afternoon, I heard a horn blowing. I looked back, and it was Buford and Emily. He got out. He said, Joe, we're going to put the bicycle in my trunk, and I'm going to drive you around Pine Bluff, because they're having the same problem that Little Rock's having. They're tearing the place apart. And he said, that little white face of yours ain't going to go good. He said, And I get in, and he turns right immediately. I said, Buford, where are you going? He said, I'm driving around the city of Pine Bluff. He said, they see us together, and he said, the niggers will get you, and the honkies will get me. And here I am, 23 years old, and that was the first time I knew that I was a honky. Serious. I didn't know I was a honky. He lets me out. A couple weeks later, my mom gets a copy of the Southern Journal. And here is my white face on the front page with his black face of the black man's Southern Journal newspaper. We had just broken some ground, okay? So, 38 years later, I ride into Little Rock. And the north side of the river, I'm on a beautiful bikeway. I look across that Arkansas River, and that beautiful city of Little Rock is shining. I mean, it is unbelievable. Totally different Little Rock than I saw 38 years earlier. I start across this bridge and right down the river, and the local people talk about this way, so it's okay for me to talk about this, okay? The local people says that it looks like a bunch of mobile homes, stacked up on top of each other, six or eight layers mobile homes, okay? And it's Bill Clinton's presidential library. I go visit. It's awesome. And Bill Clinton, he even says it too. It's kind of like, it is a beautiful building, but it does kind of resemble a bunch of mobile homes stacked up on top of each other. And then I decided, long before I got to Little Rock, that I was going to do this. But they have this fabulous, unbelievable hotel, and it's leaving my brain what it's called. But there's one in Memphis, and it's the hotel that has the mallard ducks that play in the Peabody. What is it? Peabody. The Peabody.
Peabody.
Okay, the Peabody Hotel?
Yeah, in Memphis.
Yeah, well, they got one in Little Rock. Yeah. And it's just north of where I crossed the bridge. And I knew I was going to the Peabody Hotel to get the most expensive room that I could afford in honor of Buford and Emily Gray. And I rode up to the Peabody Hotel, and this thing is out of this world. The big glass doors must be 2 inches thick. And I rode real slow up to these glass doors, and the first set of glass doors open automatically. I gently rode, never did stop the bicycle. I gently rode in, and that second set of glass doors started opening. And I rode in, and I just casually rode down through the foyer and past the fountain and the elevator and went over to the desk. And I didn't even get off the bicycle. I stood there, straddled the bicycle, and I said, "Lady, I'm looking for a room." She looking at me, she said, "I ain't never seen anybody come and get a room by driving right up to the counter." She said, "What do you want?" I said, "Well, I want something kind of expensive." She said, "Can you afford $283? I said, "Yes, ma'am, I can." She said, "That'll be on the 18th floor." And I stayed at the Peabody Hotel in honor of Buford and Emily Gray. And the next day, I found their place. It's all grown up in weeds, both places, the house and the little motel. And I stood there and had my bicycle leaned up against the sign that says Gray Street. And I stood there and I'm thinking, Buford and Emily, you was with me 38 years ago. And then it occurred to me, and you are this time too. And Buford and Emily was with me again. And I rode out. How much time I got left?
All you need.
I rode out and went on. And just a few days later, and I know you probably think that I'm making this up, but I'm not making this up. A few days later, I'm at the Capitol Building in Montgomery, and I have a glass of tea in the cafeteria on the first floor with George C. Wallace. And at that time, he was running for president of the United States. And I thought, okay, he's the governor of Alabama. And we get up, and he said, I want you to come up to the office with me. And KCOV television was with us. They was filming this. And we go down the hall, and here is a beautiful door, and it says janitor in bronze letters. And he took a key and opened it. And he said, come with me. We go into the janitor's closet, but it's not the janitor's closet. It is a secret passage up to the back end of the governor's office. And we get up there, and we're talking, and he's in a big way because he hadn't seen this kind of thing before. And I had never seen Governor Wallace before, so it was pretty exciting for me, too. And I looked on the desk. I was calling him Governor Wallace. I looked on the desk, and I realized, you're not the governor at all. On the sign on the desk, it said, Lurline B. Wallace, governor. His wife was the governor of Alabama, but he was the real governor. And I got a letter, and it's in that book where she wrote me a letter thanking me for visiting Governor Wallace and sent me an autograph, give me an autograph picture. But anyway, so, and boy, I'm gonna do it. Okay. I know I've used up too much time.
You're fine.
Okay. I've been wanting to do something for my, I've been doing stuff for my little hometown all my life, but I never did really live there to do it. After I retired, I decided I got to do something else. I'm not going to do good sitting watching television. And by the way, I run a bed and breakfast, and it doesn't have the television was unplugged 3 years ago. We don't watch television, born farm, bed and breakfast. And my friends around there said, Joe, they won't come stay with you if you don't have television. I have not had one person complain about not having a television because we have the Red River Gorge and Natural Bridge and big trees and fields and animals and deer. Why do you need a television? Amen. Anyway, I opened the bed and breakfast, and then I'm thinking about, okay, we got to do something else. So I went to the running shoe stores in Lexington, Louisville, Cincinnati, and asked them, I said, if I had a trail run, a half marathon in the gorge, would people come and run? And they said 70 to 80 people would do it the first year, and maybe 100, 120 people would do it the second year. Well, folks, the first year, 380 people came and ran the Rugged Red Trail Half Marathon, and last year, 553 people from 21 different states came and ran the Rugged Red. Now, I've done pretty good. And now I give out a lot of money to people that helps me do this. And people will tell you that you can't find volunteers. Okay, but if you got a little tumbling school over here at the elementary school, and then you got an agriculture group over here at the high school, and then you got the rescue team from Menifee, Powell, and Wolf over here, and then you got a women's club over here in Campton. All you have to do is tell them, hey, look, if you'll get together five or six people to help me make this Rugged Red happen, I'll write you a check at the end of it after I get my money. I wrote them checks, and we had a kind of a meeting for the rescue team, and I wrote each one of those rescue teams an $800 check. And one guy said, Joe! That's bigger than our whole annual budget. But anyway, you don't have a problem getting people to volunteer if you'll give them a little bit of a motivation to help you. Well, now I've still got money left. And I have been working about 3 years with the Robinson Scholars. Now, the Robinson Scholars is an organization that finances children from 29 different counties in eastern Kentucky. And they get a full education, four-year education at the University of Kentucky. And these children don't have to be, they don't have to have a 3.5, they can have a 2.8. They've got to be poor, they've got to be from poor family, and they have got to be first one in the family to get a college degree. And that's the requirement. Now, these children, I've been working with them about 3 years, and they let me come and burn, put a, set a fire under them, okay, because I'm from Eastern Kentucky. So anyway, these children, this last year, they graduated at the University of Kentucky in the top 19% of all of the graduates at the University of Kentucky. Top 19%, these are poor kids, don't have a 3.5, and have never had a college-educated person to be in their life. And they do this. So I decided that the Rugged Red is going to adopt these guys. And I made a deal with myself and the director. I said, I'm going to write a check. And I told him how much. And I started thinking, Joe, that was a little bit dumb because you ain't paid your taxes this year yet. He came to my house. He said, Joe, you don't have to write that check this year. You can start next year. I said, no. I committed to myself that I was going to do this. Well, you don't have to. And I wrote the check, very nervous. I still don't know if I'm going to have to borrow money from the bank to pay my taxes this year. Don't know that yet, but I'll know here before April 15th. Anyway, I wrote the check. And he was beside himself. And what we've done, there is a thing called the Rugged Red Scholarship Fund managed by Robinson Scholars. And it goes to that second child that don't get a college education at UK, from Menifee, Powell, and Wolf. Now, I give him the check. 2 weeks later, which was last Wednesday, I get a call from the Powell County Tourism Authority. Now, I'm telling you this story because this, you are helping the kids at NADA, okay? These are the kids, these are the kind of kids we're talking about. And you also read a Bible. And you also know a guy named Jesus, okay? Now, I wrote the check, and I'm nervous. 2 weeks later, tourism asked me to come to their meeting. I went to their meeting, and after they took care of their business, the chairman said, Joe, we've called you in here because we like what you have done for this little community. And he said, what we're going to do, if it's okay with you, we're going to give you $1,000 a month, and all you have to do is just keep on doing what you're doing. I got more than twice my money back within 2 weeks, okay?
Don't tell the IRS.
So, you all are helping those kind of kids. And I'm going to take a chance. I'm going to tell you one more story. At the end of the Stilt Walk Across America, the USJCs bought me an airline ticket and a hotel in New Orleans, Louisiana. And I went there because it was the National Speakers Association's annual meeting. And they sent me there just because they knew I loved to listen to good speakers. And I went down there, and children, I stood in the hallway and talked to Norman Vincent Peale. Just me and Norman Vincent Peale in the hallway of the hotel. Now, Norman Vincent Peale is about this tall. I didn't know that. I thought he was my size. Little man. Heard some of the great, Zig Ziglar, he was one of the speakers. A couple governors were speakers. And anyway, there was a guy named Og Mandino. And he had just written a book, We Are All Miracles of God. And he gets up on Saturday night, and he gives us about a 45-minute talk on We Are All Miracles of God. Unbelievable. Unbelievable writer, unbelievable speaker. And when he finished, he slowly walked off the podium, and after 30 or 40 seconds, 500 people jumped to their feet and started screaming and clapping. It's like, we've never heard anything like this. Well, that night, all the speakers go to their rooms and all the people like me go to their rooms, and it's over for the day. And now Sunday morning, we're going to meet, and that's going to be the last speech. And Bill Gove is going to give that last speech. And he gets up on the podium and he says, ladies and gentlemen, he said, I want to share a story with you before I do my regular speech that I was going to give. He said, last night I was in my room. And he said, I was working on this speech that I was going to give this morning. And he said, I heard a knock on the door. And he said, I opened the door, and here stood a young man and woman with washed out faces, long, sad, something was wrong with this couple. And he said, I told him, come on in, come on in. And he said, I pulled two chairs up, and I sat on the bed. And he asked this young couple, said, can I help you all? And the young man was speaking for both of them, and he said, Bill Gove, you just heard Ogmandino's speech that we're all miracles of God. Yes, I did. He said, do you believe that? And Bill Gove said, that took me back a second. And he said, I believe that we're all miracles of God. And the young man said, well, my wife and I want to ask you something. We just had a little child born to us, and it has Down syndrome. Is that a miracle of God? And Bill Gove said, I had to answer them somehow. And he said, I remembered that I had been in San Diego at the Special Olympics. And he said, I remembered these 12 little boys and girls gets out on the track, and they're going to run a mile four times around this track. And he said, I thought, okay, I'm going to tell them that story. And he went on, and he said, there's 15,000 people in this outdoor auditorium, a quarter-mile track. And he said, the gun went off, and these little kids with their different mental and physical problems took off running. And they just run their hearts out, and they ran once around that track. And he said, it seemed like for eternity, but they finally got another one around that track. And he said, in the third time, here is a group of people, 15,000, that are going, go, 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 go. And these kids are getting juiced up now, and they're running faster, and they run again. And now they're in their fourth run. And he said, well, this time, this group of people, this 15,000 people, was out of their seats, stomping the bleachers, go, 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 go. And these kids are running their hearts out, and they're within 200 feet of the finish line, and they're real close together. And one of these little boys fell and skinned his head and his knee, and he's hurt himself. And he said, do you know what those other little children did? They stopped their race and went back and picked this little boy up and put him up on his feet, and they all took off running again. And he said to this young couple, yeah, I believe we're all miracles of God. He said, you see, those children, it was more important to help someone run their race than it was for them to win their own. I thank you all for letting me do this.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. May we sing together our closing hymn, number 330. If you have a decision to make for Christ about your life, your service that's public, you come and I will share it with the congregation. If you have a decision to make that's private between you and the Lord bless you. May we sing.
Thank you.
Joe, as you can tell, it's been a blessing to have you with us, and I can't tell you how much it means to me to have Joe at NADA. If you want to hear him again, he teaches Sunday school at NADA on Sunday mornings, or Sunday afternoon, I should say, at 2:15. And we'll be there today, right?
Yes.
All right. Let's bow together for our closing prayer. And I'll ask Juanita Christian, one of our NADA workers, to lead us in our benediction.